need live stream.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. Amen.
All right, guys, let's worship with Penny's favorite song.
Every move I make in you. You make me move, Jesus. Every step I take in you.
Go to the chorus.
Waves of mercy, waves of grace.
Oh, by myself, don't wanna be alone.
Good morning, Light of the World and friends of Light of the World. We're so glad to have you here worshiping with us this morning on Sunday, April 19th, the first Sunday after Easter. If you're watching us on Facebook, I'd like to ask you to consider hosting a watch party so that your friends who might not otherwise be going to church might be able to watch our services this morning or share the link from this broadcast. And also the same if you're watching us on the website. We're starting a new message series this morning, and it's called Think About It. And what we're going to be speaking about specifically today is the concept of truth. The Bible tells us that we need to think about that, those things that are true. And in today's day and age in which people think truth is relative, this is really something that I think a lot of us could stand to hear and to think about ourselves. So we're so very glad to have you here worshiping with us. And would you join me in a word of prayer as we get started this morning? Merciful Almighty God, we just thank and praise you for this morning to be able to come together and worship you. Once again, we cannot come together as one, but we are spread out across our homes and across the city and in certain cases across this country. And we just pray that wherever we're at and however we're watching and however we're able to worship wherever we're at, that our worship of you would be as you desire to be worshiped in spirit and truth. For you are worthy of our worship and you are worthy of our praise. We just pray, gracious God, that you be with us during this time together, that not only our worship would be meaningful and that it would be appropriate in your sight, but that we would, through your word as it's preached here just a little bit later, that you would speak into our lives and that we would come to know you and come to know truth better this day. Be with us this morning, gracious God, in all that we do and all that we say. We pray this in the name that is above every name, in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen.
In the path you made,
what you have to say, more of what your scripture is filled with, life and love. Less of what the enemy says. Less of what the world says. Less of what we tell ourselves, all these doubts we create in our own minds. More of your truth. More of your word. More of you. Help us to hear you this morning, to be changed this morning by your message. In the name of Christ Jesus. Amen.
We've all had those conversations before with people where we're trying to convince them of something, but we just can't get them to understand our point. And so we'll work it, and we'll work it, and we'll work it. And in the end, we were like, all right, you may not agree with me. You may think I'm just full of a bunch of garbage or something, but I want you to just think about it. And after they spend some time thinking about it, sometimes their thought process changes, and they actually agree with us, and sometimes they don't. Well, we're going to start a new message series this morning for the next 4 weeks because the Bible tells us that there's things that we ought to think about. It comes from Philippians chapter 4, verse 8, and it says this, "Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, and whatever is right, whatever is pure and whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things." Now, I have to tell you, more than ever, this is a Bible passage we need to be paying attention to because we need to start thinking about some things other than what we've been thinking about for the last month and a half or so. I have to tell you, I'm so frustrated that I can't watch Guardians of the Galaxy without just a million public service announcements talking to me about the coronavirus. I can't watch something on the news. Dr. Phil, it doesn't matter what it is. Anything that is live right now, we're being bombarded and bombarded and bombarded by things having to do with the coronavirus. Once again, this is something that, as of this recording of this message right now on Friday, just 0.2% of all Americans have it, and just 0.2% of everyone in the world that we know of have it. So for something that is only currently impacting 0.2% of people in this country and the world, everything over and over is just about that. So because of that, I'm going to say really nothing about the coronavirus in this message, you'll find hard to believe, other than a little bit later in the message, I'm going to bring it up and talk about something as we understand what truth is. Because as we're doing this message series over the next 4 weeks, we're going to break this Bible passage apart into different sections. And so this morning, what we're going to talk about is whatever's true. God wants us to be thinking about things that are true. I remember as a kid learning the story of War of the Worlds. Now, in 1897, a book was written called War of the Worlds. And in 1938, there was a radio broadcast done about that story that was written, that book that was written in 1897. Back in the 1930s, they didn't have television, but they did have radio. So the family would gather around the radio, much like we kind of used to do around TVs and still do maybe in some homes, but now it's kind of more like computers or cell phones, and it's not everyone gathering. It's much more individualistic. But back in the 1930s, everyone comes together. You gather around the radio, and you're going to hear a story. So 1938, Orson Welles, just 23 years old, and a group of actors were going to act out, tell the story of War of the Worlds. Now, the problem was when they started telling the story, they acknowledged this was a fictional account and this wasn't real and so forth. They did all the disclaimers. But the problem was that people weren't listening at that point because that was on CBS. Instead, everyone or the largest part of the viewing audience was over on NBC, listening to NBC radio, and they were listening to a ventriloquist named Edgar Bergen and his dummy, Charlie McCarthy. Now, so they're listening to this ventriloquist, and that ended at 8:12 p.m. And what came on next on NBC was someone that was relatively obscure and not known. So everyone's switching their radios over to CBS, and they're picking up War of the Worlds 12 minutes into it after they've already done all the disclaimers. And as they're turning their stations, this is what they're hearing, and this is a quote. They're hearing the over the radio, the announcer saying, "Good heavens," he declared. "Something's wiggling out of the shadows like a gray snake. Now, wait, here's another, and here comes another one. They look like tentacles to me. I can see the thing's body now. It's large. It's large as a bear, and it's glistening like wet leather. But that face, ladies and gentlemen, it's indescribable. I can hardly force myself to keep looking at it. It's so awful. The eyes are black and they gleam like a serpent. The mouth is kind of V-shaped with saliva dripping from its rimless lips that seem to quiver and pulsate." And the guy goes on to describe what this alien invasion looks like. He says the Martians are mounting what is basically a walking war machines that are firing heat ray weapons and annihilating the puny humans that have gathered around the crash site. He goes on to say they've annihilated a force of 7,000 National Guardsmen after being attacked by the artillery and the bombers, the Martians are releasing poisonous gas into the air. Then they go on to say that now more Martians are starting to land in Chicago and St. Louis. The radio was so realistic. The actors were doing such a good job that the people that were hearing this story in progress, even though it was disclaimed at the very beginning, panic erupts. The accounts tell us that actually the police department, New York City Police Department, come to the radio station and they're beating down the doors to try to get in to stop this broadcast that's creating havoc. A Midwestern mayor is calling the radio station in real time because people are beginning to riot and just panic in their town. People take to the streets. There's reports of people committing suicide because they don't want to be abducted by and captured by the Martians. It's crazy that people took this story that was fictional, that wasn't real, and because of how it was being presented, they assumed and believed it to be real. Here's a literal article from the New York Times that talked about what took place, and you see it says, "Radio listeners in panic, taking war drama as fact." Well, I share this with you because the Bible tells us that we need to focus on that which is true. And truth is so easily manipulated. Truth is so easily corrupted. You hear the phrase all the time, perception is reality. Listen, perception isn't truth, but perception becomes reality, and reality now isn't really linked to truth the way that it should be. Now, I mentioned that I wasn't going to really address the coronavirus other than in this section. So when we think about the coronavirus and everything that's going on, perception is that this is, you know, mammoth numbers statistically across the world and the nation, and that's not reality. But you have to understand it through the eyes of the people who are giving us their version of reality. Now, if it's a doctor giving their version of reality, you would expect for a doctor that every life matters, and every life, even out of 7.5 billion, is of utmost precedence to the fact that nothing compares to that. Now, an economist is going to see reality a different way, right? An economist is going to be like 140,000 people in the world, 30,000 people in America, 20 million unemployed, 1 out of 7 unemployed. Where's the equality in the lives that are ruined this way versus the lives that are ruined that way? They see truth and reality a different way. Now I'll take that over to media. Media knows that we don't want to just hear the ordinary things. We can observe the ordinary things. We're not going to read their article. We're not going to watch the news shows for things that we already get, we've already heard, we already understand. So they sensationalize things that truly do happen, but they're talking about crazy things that happen because no one's going to listen to normal things. So as they always report on the extremes, suddenly our perception, our reality becomes extremes is what reality is. But you see, extremes aren't reality either. So people, because of their own biases, people because of their own ignorances, people because of just how they view the world, give different understandings and views of reality, but that doesn't mean that it's ultimately truth. And so for the sake of, the Bible says we need to focus on that which is true. As of Friday, as I'm recording this, actually it doesn't matter because the statistics that I had went back to 2016, I believe. I've got a chart for you in 2016. These are the top 10 global causes of death. And this was the most recent information that I had because it takes a while to compile facts across the whole world. But there you see the top 10 ways that people have died in 2016. Now let's look at number 10, tuberculosis. You see it's just under, it looks like on that graph, 2 million, so maybe 1.8 million or so. Now as of the time that I am recording this on Friday, I believe the world count was 148,000. So now, even though things are starting to plateau deaths in this country and they're talking about potentially reopening, and in other parts of the world, the numbers are starting to go down. If you multiply the amount of deaths in this world times 7, in other words, if for the rest of the year it gets 7 times worse than it currently is, you're still only halfway up to what's number 10 on that list. I have to tell you, I tried to pull up the top 20 ways that people die in this world so that I could kind of get a understanding of, okay, if this gets 7 times worse and we get up to 1 million in the world, what would that look like? I mean, I'm to like looking at categories like accidental injury, right? Can you imagine if every news show for a month was about accidental injury, and every episode of Dr. Phil was about accidental injury, and every other commercial is public service announcements about accidental injury. I mean, that is the level that we've elevated this to because of, well, there's a variety of different reasons, one of them being it's a political season. And in a political season, people are really concerned about what perception is, because remember, people turn perception into reality. All right, that's pretty much it. I might have one other reference when I get to another section. But what I want to do is I want to help us all understand how we process through life and how we discover truth. If the Bible says that think about truth, what are things that cause us to sometimes miss-see and misunderstand truth? I want to give you a few categories here. The first is this, our wants. The things that we want cause us to miss-see truth. Now, there's no greater example of this than in the sports world, right? What happens at the start of every football season? It doesn't matter if you're a New Orleans fan or if you're a Seattle Seahawks fan. It doesn't matter if you're a Buffalo Bills fan, right? Everyone's thinking that at the start of the football season, my team's got a chance. My team, they might win the Super Bowl this year. This last season, Cowboys fans, you know what I'm talking about. The Cowboys, they had great expectations. People thought they were going to go to the Super Bowl. They had all this talent. But as the season wore on, the Cowboys were just like at 500. And their division was so weak that the leader of the division was right around 500. I can't tell you how many times I heard towards the latter weeks of the season, you know what, the Cowboys, you know, we can still kind of get on a roll here and we can make a run into the playoffs and we can win the Super Bowl. What version of truth and reality was that, right? There was no indication before that the Cowboys were going to do that. They were playing awful. And in fact, they didn't even make the playoffs. And so that's where, once again, we see that our wants obscure truth. So we've got to be careful that we're not allowing that to happen. Now, mind you, wants can help us to obtain certain things in life. You know, if you wanted to be a professional athlete, if you wanted to be a singer, a rock star or something, you know, some people do achieve that, so our wants motivate us, but our wants, likely because they skew reality, keep us from achieving reality. All the people that think they're going to be a professional athlete, a rock star, or a professional singer that ultimately don't miss out on achieving reality because their expectations were never real to begin with. So our wants cause us to miss out and to misunderstand reality. Now, a cousin to want is greed. Greed is a form of want, but greed can cause us to misunderstand and misinterpret reality. No greater example of that in American history was in 1848 in California, gold was discovered. And that started in 1849, this great rush from people all across this country to California, and even people across the world to California, because everyone, because of greed, their perception of reality was, their perception of truth was, is I'm going to go to California and I'm going to strike it rich. It didn't happen for the vast majority of people. In fact, people experienced just the opposite when they got to California. So many people came to California during the gold rush that in 1848, when it started, the population of the state was like 160,000. Over the next 2 years, twice as many, like 320, 340,000 new people come, and the state just explodes from all these people. They believe that truth is that you can find gold anywhere and you're going to strike it rich. When they got there, that wasn't the case at all. The conditions were deplorable. Disease was rampant. I was shocked when I did a little research on it. Do you know that back in the 1848, 1849, when people were going to these small mining towns, do you know that a single egg cost $3 back then in some of these towns? That is the equivalent of $80 per egg in today's money. These same people that just knew their version of reality and truth was they were going to strike it rich, a bag of flour back then in a lot of these mining towns cost you $13 back then. That is the equivalent to paying $365 today for a bag of flour. This is a quote from a miner about what life was like back then. He said, "There is a good deal of sin and wickedness going on here, stealing and lying and swearing, drinking, gambling, and murdering." Kind of sounds like today. But nonetheless, their version of truth, hey, I'm going to strike it rich, everything's going to be great, this is going to be awesome, right? It wasn't true. It wasn't reality. Wants cause us to skew truth. Greed causes us to skew truth. Fear. Fear is a big one that can cause us to skew truth. So you've heard the phrase snake oil salesman. That actually comes back from the time of the gold rush to California. People were getting sick. Different things were going on, and they didn't have a solution for it. Either they didn't know what the solution was, or it wasn't available. So they would just sell these products that they claimed would solve things. And out of fear, people would take the snake oil. People would take the tonic water, and they would think that it would make them better. That's not truth, and that's not reality, but fear causes us to not care about truth and reality. Fear causes us to obscure truth and reality. If I can make one other kind of connection into what's going on today, you know, we've seen this kind of whole progression of, well, this is going to happen. Oh, okay, it didn't happen, so, well, the next wave is going to be worse, and the yardstick keeps moving. It started out, we weren't supposed to wear a mask. Now we are supposed to wear a mask. A lot of people think that wearing a mask or wearing a bandana over their face is going to protect them from the virus. Absolutely not. That's not true. Go ahead and read it on the CDC, John Hopkins. Anything will tell you that the virus particle is not stopped at all by, you know, anything short of the top masks that they have, the N95s that they're talking about, or surgical masks. What those masks do is when you sneeze, when you cough, it keeps your droplets from kind of going out in the air, but it does nothing to protect you. So once again, people misunderstand what truth is because fear causes us to want to believe things that otherwise aren't true. And when fear causes us to misunderstand truth, then we overreact, and that's not good for us. Think about like when you're driving down I-35, the tire blows out or an animal runs in front of you, and you're going, you know, 80, 85 miles an hour. If you overreact with that wheel, you're going to make that situation a whole lot worse for you than what it otherwise would be. So when fear keeps us from understanding truth and reality, that can be a very dangerous thing. All right, next thing that keeps us from seeing truth and reality sometimes, friends and family. I understand that your parents told you that if you crack your knuckles, you're going to get arthritis. Not true. I understand all our moms told us if you cross your eyes, they're going to stay that way. Not true. But how many of us believed it? How many of us have told our kids that, right? So the things that we hear from friends and family are sometimes good and informative, but sometimes the things that we hear from people that are close to us is actually not true, and we just kind of believe it. I have to tell you, people send me quotes all the time or images where people are kind of making a correlation between something that happened now and something someone promised many years ago or so forth. I almost always just don't believe it. And then I'll go to Snopes to kind of check it out. Why? Because it's so easy to forge things and people are so quick to believe and buy things that aren't true. I want to encourage you with one thing that Ronald Reagan said, many things that many people appreciate, but I really appreciate this. He always said this about the Soviet Union: trust, but verify. I'm here to tell you, when the people who are close to you, and this is why we got to be careful who's close to us, because we're very much influenced and our understanding of reality and of truth is influenced by them. But when someone that is close to us, friends or family, tell us things or say certain things, trust, but verify, so that we can be certain that what we're believing is true and we're not passing along things that are untrue. Society is another big one that skews our perception of truth. You know what? It always used to be in this country, whatever happened in New York and whatever happened in California would eventually filter to the middle part of the country. Now, that was never a flattering thing, because New York and California oftentimes do things that are somewhat weird and kind of pushing the envelope. But you know what? For the most part, it was always a Christian nation, so those were the underlying values. So it didn't kill us that which came from New York and California would make its way to the middle part of the country. But society's different nowadays. We have a one-world society. Now what happens in Asia will go to Europe, which will come to America. So it's not what happens in New York and California now becomes truth in middle America. It's what's happening across the world. And I'm here to tell you, in other places of the world, they don't have the same values that we do. They don't have the same Christian values and principles. They don't understand truth the same way that we understand it, looking at it through our Christian perspective. And so this is very dangerous, that not just things from the coast kind of spread in across the country, but when things from across the world, across society, that hold views totally in opposition to what our country has always stood for or believed in, now are coming and being part of our thinking. This is very dangerous. Lastly, and then I want to get to how we do understand truth, media and influencers affect our perception of truth. If you don't think so, you're just fooling yourself. We all have our own beliefs, and we do our best to try to communicate those beliefs. I'm doing that to you right now, but I firmly believe that I'm doing it based upon God's word, and that's what God tells the preachers to do. It's what God tells the church to do, that we communicate his truth to the world around us. But the media does the same thing with their own views that they have, and I love it. Nowadays in social media, at least they're a lot more upfront and honest about it. You will hear people say that they're social media influencers. That's right. Companies will pay people to influence you, to get you to think a certain way and to believe a certain way. It's true. Research it if you've never heard it, especially if you're like an older generation. Research influencers and see that there's this whole industry, this whole movement out there where people's jobs are and they get paid to try to influence the thought of other people. All right. How do we do, if the Bible says that we need to think about truth, and we have all these ways in which truth is being kind of skewed in our minds, perception is being corrupted, how do we focus on what God tells us to focus? Well, ultimately, it's the Bible. It starts with the Bible and it ends with the Bible. The Bible is the voice of truth. Look at John chapter 8, verses 31 to 32. To the Jews who had believed in him, Jesus said this. He said, if you hold to my teachings, you are truly my disciples. And then what? You will know the truth. And what? That truth will set you free. You see, it's God's word that helps us to understand truth. People believe that truth is relative, but it's not. God is the author of truth, and when we understand things through God's word, that truth will set us free. Here's the problem. God is truth, and his word is truth. That's not the problem. The problem is that Satan is called what? He's called the father of lies. So Satan is using all these other means that I've already talked about, and there's many more. I just don't have the time to keep going on and on with all the things that corrupt our view of truth. But Satan is the father of lies, is working against it. The only way that you can and I can have an understanding of what truth is that it's through God's word, because God is the creator of truth, and so his word tells us what truth really is. When we understand life, we need to understand through God's word, because it's God's word that will help us to recognize truth for what it is. Now, here's the deal. So few of us, even though the Bible is how we now understand life to understand what truth is, so few of us are reading the Bible. I get that, like, there's all these, like, Bible programs that are sending out the verse of the day. And I don't mean to minimize it, but I'm going to. A verse of a day is like getting a grain of rice a day. It's good. It'll feed you. But you will be malnourished if all you're eating is a grain of rice a day or a spoonful of rice. That's what a verse a day will do. It's better than nothing, I suppose. But if we're going to understand truth, we need to be in God's word, and we need to read God's word, because God's word will help us to understand in all these different applications of life what is truth and what is not. We also understand truth through the cross, because it's through the cross that we know who God is and what God's heart is. It doesn't matter if it's a coronavirus or if it's a car accident in which someone dies or someone gets cancer, or, you know, all these terrible, hurtful, horrific things that happen as we go through life. You know, sometimes people will question, you know, where's a loving God in this? You know what? All you have to do is look to the cross. And when you look to the cross, you can be certain that God is love, that God does, you know, love his creation, that he was willing to send his one and only son to suffer and to die. So that even when horrific and bad things happen in this life, we will receive that life that God had actually intended for us all along, a life in union and communion with him forever in heaven. So we don't have to question who God is when bad things happen. The cross tells us the truth about God, but that cross also tells us the truth about ourselves, of our importance to God, that God loved you and that God loved me so much that he was willing to die for us. So when people try to get us to think that maybe God doesn't care about us or this, that, we know that's not true. Why? Because the cross gives us the truth of God. So I want to encourage you with this. The Bible says we need to think about that which is true. And the only way that we can do that is by being in God's word. So please stop listening to the news, Dr. Phil, and all this stuff on television. Put down your phones. Pick up the Bible, read the Bible, and understand truth. Understand God's truth through the cross about how much God loves you and how much God loves me. Then when you understand truth in that way, you will have what the Bible describes as a peace that passes our ability to understand. Then you will know the truth, and then you will, as a result of that truth, be set free. Would you join me in a word of prayer? Merciful God, as we reflect upon this message, as we think about it this morning, I just pray that you would help us to think about truth. Truth not as people try to sell it to us, some intentionally trying to deceive us, and just some people out of their own ignorance. Help us to know truth through your eyes, through what is ultimately reality and not perception. And we just pray, gracious God, that in everything that's going on in our lives, that especially as fear predominates more and more, fear of losing our jobs and paying bills. It's just so many people are being ravaged by that right now, and for those that are being sick, and for those who are struggling in many different ways, that we would not overreact, but that we would be firmly rooted in the truth, and that through that truth, you would ultimately set us free. You are the author of that truth. We thank you for your word, and we pray that by your spirit, we would make use of it. In Jesus' name, amen. I mentioned in my video, actually I forgot to mention in my video I sent out on Wednesday, but I put it in a little caption and I hope everyone read it, but I had a member that suggested this to me a couple weeks ago, but now that the checks are coming out, I want to mention it. A member said, you know what, he said, I feel like standing up and saying, for everyone that's receiving checks from the government and haven't had their hours cut, use that money to help people who are, especially now that 7 million people one out of seven people, over 20 million people have lost their jobs. I want to encourage you. I agreed with him when he said it, and I've I'm living it out myself, and I know others who are doing it, and this isn't so that, hey, we can just put extra money in the bank. It's our opportunity to be a light to the world around us. Our opportunity to help people in the darkest days so that what? Glory can come to God in heaven. So I want to challenge you. Take a portion of it if you don't want to do all of it. Take a tenth of it. Take half of it. That seems at least fair, right? But do something to bless people who you know are hurting. If you don't know of people who are hurting, I do, and myself and the church can help you in that process. Just let me know if you need some help in it. But I want to encourage you to be a light to people around you that way. We want to continue this morning in our celebration of Easter and that Jesus rose from the dead. So our closing song this morning will be the closing song from Easter a week ago as we continue to celebrate that our God's not dead, that Christ has been raised from the dead, and that you and I have our hope and we have our eternal life in him. I hope and pray that all of you have a wonderful week, and I look forward to seeing you again soon. God bless.
Sealed the promise, your best.
silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. You're buried.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Amen.
All right, guys, let's worship with Penny's favorite song.
Every move I make in you. You make me move, Jesus. Every step I take in you.
Go to the chorus.
Waves of mercy, waves of grace.
Oh, by myself. Every day to the death, your joy overtakes, and I can't forget about it. Oh.